This time I'm going to ask my oldest boy to come up here and minister to us this morning and be led by the Holy Spirit of God, which he always is.
Hallelujah.
Good to have you home. You're in Jerry Ann.
Glad to have you guys. Jesus is here now.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Good to have you guys home.
Amen.
Come on, give him a big clap this morning.
Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, if you can't get excited in an atmosphere like your pulse. Amen. And for those that, you know, you don't want nobody to know that you're here, you're already here. They already know it. So you might as well go on and get excited about Jesus anyway. Amen. You ain't fooling nobody sneaking in, sitting in the back and everything like that. Look, they already know you're here. So you might as well go on and just get it for everything you can get. Amen. This is the day the Lord hath made, and the Bible said that we shall rejoice. I said we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. So you might as well go on and get excited about Jesus this morning. I said you might as well go on and get excited about Jesus this morning. Hallelujah. The greater one is here this morning. The Savior's here this morning. The Redeemer's here this morning. Come on now. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, turn to somebody and say, I don't know about you, but I am ready. Amen. And you may be seated this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. You know, I only have you for one service, one pop, you know, which is very unusual for me nowadays, you know, because all of our services are 5 days, 6 days, 7 days. And so, you know, a lot of times because when I go in, I have, you know, the Holy Spirit gives me a theme and a vein, you know, that we flow into. And so I thought I was going to preach one particular message. I had prepared, you know, I had already prepared when I was coming in. And then yesterday I got alone and just began to just meditate on what I wanted to preach on. Notice I said what I wanted to preach on. So at 6 o'clock this morning, the Holy Spirit woke me up and said, I don't want you to preach that this morning. I want you to preach something else. And so I went into my dad's office this morning real early and just began to pray and meditate. And so this is fresh from the throne room this morning. Amen. Amen. And I'm going to do my best to teach it, and which is hard for me sometimes. And because we go in and, you know, our crusades are called Fresh Fire Crusades. And then, you know, when, so we're going to ignite a fire, to light a fire. And we just came in from Flint, Michigan, and up there at a Cogent church. I mean, that's what a Cogent church is. And it's been so awesome. God's opening doors, and we're breaking all barriers in religion. And so it's really cool and what God is doing. And you talking about Holy Ghost time. I mean, I just had to let them go, and when they wore themselves out, then we sit down and we get into it. You know, because everybody plays an instrument in the Cogent church. You know, everybody sings and everybody shouts and everybody dances, you know, but we had a tremendous pastors up there in Flint, Michigan. And so the head bishop called, and while I was there doing the meeting and everything, and he told the pastor, he says, I want him in my church. Go ahead and give me all the information. And he's the head of all the state of Michigan and of the Kojic organization. And so we're just interesting to see what God is doing. And amen. And so we're getting ready to go to England and doing crusades over in England. And we're just traveling all over the world, just spreading the gospel of Jesus. Amen. But when we go in for a purpose and a reason. I just don't go to preach a message. So if you're here just to hear another message, then you're in the wrong place. You know, I kind of take after my dad, you know, just a little bit. And if it's interesting, because, you know, I worked here for almost 25 years. And it was so funny because mom would talk about how it was just, we'd show up every Sunday dressed just alike. You know, and daggone, this morning I come to church and we're dressed just alike. You know, so that same anointing just rose right back in. We just pick up where I left off, you know. And even my uncle got into it, and he's dressed just like us this morning, you know. And my brother, he's got the same now. He kind of missed it on the jacket part, but he got the pants and the shirt right. But, you know, he's almost there. He's getting there. Amen. But it is awesome. It's such a great to be home. you know, this is always home, and it's good to see your faces this morning. But I want to share this morning. I want to accomplish something this morning. Amen. I believe when we come together in like mind and like spirit and like faith, that the Holy Spirit brings you here this morning to accomplish something. Amen. We just don't come to church just for a gathering and just for, you know, a social club. But we come to church so that the Holy Spirit can accomplish some things in our life. Amen. And I'm here this morning with the Holy Spirit to accomplish some things that I want to share with you, and that will establish you some things, and that'll help you. Amen. And so listen to me very carefully, because I don't want to be accused of anything, of the title of my message. The title of my message is If You. Okay, that's the title of my message, all right? And so I don't want to be accused of anything, so that's the title of my message this morning. The Webster Dictionary says it like this. The word if is used, it's a conjunction, and I'm excited that my wife's probably in shock right now that I knew that, but I did some studying this morning. I did some English studying this morning. But it's a conjunction word, and it is used to say something. It is used to say something that must happen. Now think about that. This is the Webster Dictionary, the word if. It is used to say something that must happen before anything can happen. Now you'll see where we're going with this thing in a few moments. But if you just grasp a hold of it, because the Bible says, if you call on the name of the Lord Jesus. Huh? So that tells me that Jesus is already here. He already wants to do something. The Holy Spirit's already here waiting on you. Now think about this for a moment. And this is not in my text, but I want to share this with you just for a moment. The Holy Spirit just said, drop this in me to remind you this. In Genesis chapter 1, it says, in the beginning was... No, that's John. Come on. Was the heavens and the earth? God created the heavens and the earth. Come on now, amen? And then the next verse 2 says, "In the there was deepness upon the face of the earth, and there was emptiness in the empty waste." Yeah. All right? So there was darkness there. But the Bible says that the Holy Spirit hovered. Now that tells me that the Holy Spirit, because we know God always is, always has been, and always will be. He's, you know, and you can't sit there with your mind and figure out how this is, but it just is. Amen. He is. Amen. When you say he is, that means he's before beginning, he's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He was before it was, and he will always be when it is. And don't ask me to repeat that. But when you think about it, the Bible says that in the beginning was the heavens and the earth, and the earth was that form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit Lord hovered upon this. And when the Holy Spirit hovered, that tells me that there's always an opportunity for something to happen. But notice this, that the Holy Spirit could not even do anything, even though he may wanted to do something, but he couldn't do anything until somebody said something. See, when the Bible says, and God said, and when God said, matter of fact, the Message Bible says like this. He just says, God said light. He just spoke one word. He said light. And the Bible says there was instantaneous light. Now, we understand there is darkness always there. Kind of like some of your situations in your life, you see it as darkness. But God doesn't see it as darkness. He sees it as an opportunity for light. And the Holy Spirit was always there, even though the Satan ruled the earth and ruled the darkness of the deep and all that and everything, even in the midst of all that junk, all that ugliness, in the midst of all your situations, in the midst of no matter what situation you deal with, no matter what family situation you deal with, no matter what financial situation, how dark it may be, the Holy Spirit's hovering. And he's waiting. He's just waiting because he can't do anything, even though he wants to. And he's chomping at the bit to do something. And he's just, he's begging you, please, just tell me. Just say something to me so I can do something. But he can't do anything until you say something. Amen. But your words, and watch this, your words will not do anything. He will not ever be moved by your words. In your own natural abilities, in your own self-gratification, in your own righteousness, because he doesn't recognize your words. Because it's not his language. The only language he understands and the only language that he will respond to is the Father's language. See, and this is what happens in the body of Christ in churches all the time. You know, and I know my dad, he's taught this for years and years and years, talking about what you say and dealing with this subject. And people quote scripture. How many here has ever quoted scripture? And you know, and we've always said this, you know, find a scripture, stand on it. And yet it didn't work. Now think about it. I know every one of y'all must raise your hand and say, yeah, I've quoted a scripture many times and it didn't work. Matter of fact, I'm dealing with some situations right now. I'm quoting scripture, but yet it just hasn't come to existence yet. Amen. Come on now. Yeah. Well, the reason why a lot of times that's not working is because you're trying to do it in your own words, in your own language, in your own abilities, instead of going it through him, the greater one who lives inside of you. Amen. See, this is what Paul said. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 31, he says, I die daily. Now, we did communion this morning. And in the communion this morning, we do that. Why do we take communion? It is to put ourselves in remembrance. Didn't the Bible say? As a matter of fact, he said, put me in remembrance. Jesus said in his word, he said, put me in remembrance of my words. What he says in Psalms. He said, put me in remembrance of my word. Does he not say that? Yes. So we take communion as a representation of what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. But watch this. It is also reminds us of who Christ is and what he did. So when Paul said this, I die daily to my flesh, we see that word and we understand it and we see it as him putting his flesh under. That is true. But the point of it is, this is what's all entailed when he says, I die daily. He says, I put myself in remembrance of my salvation. In other words, he's saying, I put myself back in the experience. Oh, come on. He says, this is what he said when he said, I die daily, because in Luke's gospel, lest Satan should get the advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. That's what the scripture says. And so Paul didn't want Satan to get the advantage of him. He wanted to take advantage of Satan. And so when you think about this, so when he said, I die daily to my flesh, what he was saying is, he says, I put myself back in remembrance. He said, I place myself in that remembrance of what actually took place in my life the day that I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior. Because if you can put yourself back, think about this. The experience, and most of you can, if you really, really think, I mean, when you got saved, the service that you got saved in, if you can go back that far, if you can put yourself in remembrance of what it was like, I mean, it was just incredible experience, because God, in his infinite self, sent the Holy Spirit here to do a blood transfusion in your life, to take your stuff that is worthless and give you his stuff that is invaluable. Amen. And so he took your abilities, which was nothing, and he put himself in you. You understand, when we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, what takes place? He literally, watch this, he literally puts himself in you. So it would behoove you to find out what the word says of who you actually are. Because the moment you can identify yourself, see, because what happens is when you start, now all of a sudden you look in the mirror, you're not looking at yourself, you're not looking at your blemishes, you're not looking at what you don't like, you're looking in the mirror and you're not seeing you, but you're seeing Christ in you. But see, what happens is a lot of times we forget who we are. And so we have to remind ourselves. That's why Paul said, I die. He constantly put himself in remembrance of what took place at the cross, what Jesus did, everything that he done, how he took him from being who he was as Paul, gave him a new name, gave him a new name, which he was Saul, but now he's Paul, gave him a new name, so he's not even himself anymore. Amen. Think about that. So when you get born again, you're not operating in your name anymore. You're not operating in your name anymore because in your name, there's no power. See, in your name, there's no authority. The devil will look at you and you call out your name. He said, who are you? Come on now. He said, I don't know who you are. What do you think I'm going to do? I'm not scared of you. You don't affect my life. You don't do anything to me. But when you go in through his name, oh, come on. I love Ephesians chapter 1, I think it's verse 24. It says, every name that is named. We have authority over every name that is named. Now think about it. It is in his name. You know, yesterday, you know, we had a wedding, his youngest son, Brandon, got married, and my brother did the ceremony last night. And so I'm sitting there, you know, and of course, you know, I'm proud uncle and all that, you know, and I'm putting myself in remembrance as a little boy and as a little boy and coaching him all those years with my brother and all the things, you know, the hunting and everything that we did. So I'm sitting there just remembering all this stuff. And now all of a sudden, he's not that boy anymore. He's not that, I mean, even those experiences happened, but he's not that little boy anymore. And so now I look at him, and he's got his beautiful bride standing up there, and they're standing there, and he's just looking at her, and I'm praying that he'll remember that moment for the rest of his life. Because see, this is what happened, because at that moment, if you've ever been married, those that are not married, you just have to hold on for a second, but I'm telling you. You'll experience it when you get married. But the day, the wedding day, and you see that bride coming for the very first time, and you're standing, I've been married going on 31 years. And I'm only 39 years old. Told you I'd take after my daddy. But I remember standing up here and at the time, and we didn't have this circle, you know, we just had this pulpit just up here. We just had this area. And I remember standing up here, and I'm just with anticipation of what I'm about to see and what I'm about to experience. Come on now. Glory to God. So all of a sudden, those doors open. And yesterday I'm sitting there and I've got my camera, my phone, and I got my video, and they're playing this music, and all the, you know, the bridesmaids come up and the groomsmen are already there, my brother, and then they've already made their entrance, and everybody's anticipating. Everybody stands up. We ain't seen her yet, but everybody stand up with anticipation. Now at that moment, watch this. At that moment, there was nobody out there that wasn't expecting her not to show up. We all stood, sinners and saints alike. Come on now. And we all stood there waiting with anticipation for the bride. And the music's playing, and everybody can't hardly wait to see this beautiful bride, and our anticipation can't even compare, I'm sure, to my nephew. And he's standing up there, you know, and he's got his brother beside him, and he's got his cousin beside him, and just anticipation. And then all of a sudden, she appears. And I took the picture, I snapped the picture of his face. I zoomed in, and I snapped the picture of his face when he first saw her. And the look on his face, the look on his face, it was just, there was no judgment. There was no just anything other than, that's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. He's in awe He's in all of her. This is what Paul was talking about. When he said, I die daily, he literally puts himself back in that moment. He puts himself back in that moment where he first experienced the greatest love of his life. So, and the reason why he knew the importance of that, because you know, if you know anything, if you study the Bible, and if you've been here, you understand, Paul was beaten 4 times, 39 strikes. You can't humanly possibly deal with that. The only way that's possible is through Christ. So in the middle of him being thrown in prison, in the middle of him being beaten, in the middle of him being persecuted, in the middle of him being thrown in front of kings and all that and being accused, that's why he was able to say in front of King Agrippa, he said, I think myself happy. Because at that moment of all the persecution, of everyone coming against him, he placed himself right back to the moment of his first love that he experienced when he accepted Christ as his Lord and Savior. Now you have a tremendous opportunity every day. You shouldn't have to wait to come to Sunday service or come to Wednesday night service prayer meetings and Bible studies to wait to have that experience. That experience should be the first moment you get out of your bed and your feet hit the floor. Your first moment, that's why Paul said that first moment is when he hits up and he wakes his eyes up to a new day. He puts himself in that moment, just like my nephew yesterday in that wedding. And, you know, my brother, he was up there and he was doing the ceremony and I was listening to the words, you know, of what he was telling them and how they were committing themselves one to another. And in one particular area of the ceremony, he goes, and this is for life. And my brother even said, he said, now listen, remember, he said, there are going to be some things that are going to happen, but you remember this moment when you say, I do. See, one of the problems with the body of Christ is we really are not putting ourselves in position and we're not saying, I do. Therefore, there's not a relationship. See, we can have all the religion in the world and just, you know, let me just mess your heads up. You can have all the religion in the world and yet not have relationship and live hell right here on earth. You do know religion is not from God. See, just being a member of church doesn't make you saved. People say, you know, that's why Satan takes advantage of them. Because they're ignorant. I'm just telling you, I'm not telling you you're ignorant. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. Because the Bible says, Hosea 4, we're destroyed for lack of knowledge. How? We're destroyed for lack of knowledge. And so what happens is we get destroyed because we don't know. People say it all the time. They say, well, they found religion. No, they didn't find God. Amen. They what they found, listen, this is what they found. They found a way of doing things with themselves, just in a different way. But they ain't found God. Because see, this is what happens. The moment you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, now all of a sudden, you go from God mentality, if you allow it, and if you truly commit yourself. So you'll go from God mentality to daddy mentality, because there's a huge difference. There are millions of biological fathers in the world. Millions of biological fathers in the world, but there's only a few daddies. Huh? Millions of biological fathers, but only a few daddies. Because, see, the difference between a father mentality or God mentality and a daddy mentality is that you have this mentality that daddy said he'll never leave you nor will he ever forsake you. Daddy will be there. He'll train you. He'll teach you. He'll make sure that you're taken care of. I have three girls of my own, and my oldest is one that's up there on the keyboard, those that don't know, but that's my oldest, if you can't tell. And then I got my middle daughter who's here this morning, and I'm getting ready to be a granddaddy. I'm gonna be one of the youngest granddaddies in the world at 39 years old. And what's the interesting thing is that my dad's only 39 years old, so he's gonna be the youngest, greatest granddaddy.
Same age.
But with my girls, and then I got my youngest one who's getting ready to be 20. I mean, it's just time just flying by, and I mean, it's just amazing. And all my girls were born here in this ministry. And so, and my girls, I tell you, I love them. I mean, there's nothing I wouldn't do for them. There's nowhere I would be in this world that I wouldn't get back if they needed me. But see, I didn't learn that on my own. See, that's why it's a generation curse, and why families struggle and struggle and struggle, because they're taking what they don't know into another relationship that they don't know. Into another relationship that they don't know. And that's why Satan doesn't want you in a church like this, because once you get in a church like this that teaches the word, and all of a sudden you become not ignorant anymore, and all of a sudden you become knowledgeable, and all of a sudden then you begin to take advantage of here. Huh? And so I didn't learn this on my own. I sat under somebody that knew how to be there. I had a great example. I had a great teacher, someone that knew how to, that spent time with us, me and my brother, and poured all himself into us. And when I say all himself, he poured all himself. Even when he didn't have time, and he in the early years, and he was pioneering churches and building churches and having to drive the school bus and teach Sunday school and go preach a message and going through all this, and yet he would take the time out to take my brother hunting, me and my brother, take us fishing and coach us in baseball. Even when he didn't have time, he had time. How much more? See, when you understand this and how God wants not to be just God to you, because listen, the world has a God mentality. ISIS has a God mentality. You've heard me say this. Satan has a God mentality. He talks to God. He has a relationship with God. Not a relationship, but they talk, they communicate. Read your Bible. But it's interesting, even though he knows God, he talks to God, it doesn't change his past, it doesn't change his present, and it cannot and will not change his future. And that's why Christians today, they come to church, leave the way they came in the same way that they came, because they're trying to live this Christianity in their own abilities, in their own strength, in their own way of thinking, instead of realizing who their daddy is and become a deal with the relationship aspect, because you really never had said, I do. See, you have to say, I do. You got to come in. See, my nephew and his girlfriend at that moment. Now, watch this. They were boyfriend and girlfriend. Standing up there, holding hands. During the whole ceremony, they're still not married. They're still not that relationship there. They're not one. Until my brother asked them to say, the vows. And then my brother says this, do you? In other words, you can even say, like, he says, if you will say this, if you will do this, if you'll repeat this after me, and if you will believe, sure, I have time to get all into that. But if you'll believe, the Bible says, you go back to Romans chapter 10, verse 9, it says, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your what? Because see what happens is there's a marriage ceremony that's literally a spiritual marriage ceremony, a supernatural marriage ceremony that's taking place the moment you realize you need Jesus, you need to have a relationship, and the moment that you accept him as your Lord and Savior, you've had a ceremony that puts your, and you gave up your name. Now you take on his name. So you lay yourself aside, just like, you know, Stephanie, she was up there, and, you know, and as my brother said anything, they said, I do. The moment that they said, I do. And my brother said this. He said, you may kiss the bride, which is the best part of the whole ceremony. Well, it's for me. I can't tell you one thing my dad said, but I remember the kiss. Because you can sit there and laugh, but how many times you go leave church? You go home, you can't remember what the pastor said, but you can remember the kiss from the Holy Ghost. And when I say kiss, I'm talking about that experience, that feeling of not just your natural feeling, but I'm talking about that atmosphere when you really get in and when you enter in, because you can't enter in unless you say I do. And see, this is why you're constantly battling, why you're constantly going through, because you're having an unspiritual relationship, because you can't have a supernatural daddy relationship and Father, Son, and Holy Ghost relationship until you commit yourself, until you say, I do, and give up your name and take his name. Brother, I don't know about you, but I'm enjoying myself. And so when you grasp a hold of this, and when my brother, I love this part because, you know, my brother, after they were holding hands, you know, and my nephew was rubbing her arm. I mean, he was just, everything about him, he at that moment of the ceremony, at that moment, he was literally, she was giving herself all to him. At that moment, they didn't see no faults. At that moment, they didn't see nothing other than the love. Look, it was 31 years, almost 31 years ago. And I'm going to tell you right now, I can still remember that moment. Amen. I can go back further than that. I can remember the first day I've ever saw her, what she was wearing. Amen. At our church on Ward Boulevard at the old ranch house. When she walked in the back door of the sanctuary. And I said, my God, who's that angel? I'm not evangelistically speaking. I literally asked her brother, who is that angel? I said, who in the world is that? And he kept looking. He said, who are you talking about? See, he could say it because he knew her. He didn't see the angel side. Huh? He knew the natural side, but I won't look at the natural side. And so he goes, who are you talking about? I said, that person right there. He goes, where? She walked in with her sister. I said, no, her. He goes, ooh, my sister? I said, dude, you didn't even tell me you had a sister. And we were best friends. Didn't even know you had a sister that looked like that. I mean, and see, these experiences can't even compare. Can't even compare when you truly accept Jesus as your Lord and get in a covenant. See, yesterday when my brother was doing the ceremony and through all this stuff that was happening, there was a spiritual thing that was taking place. Amen. Because, you know, marriage is spiritual. Now watch this. Now I don't want to mess your head up too much this morning, but it's all right, Daddy can fix it next Sunday. I'm blowing in, blowing out. But just because you have a marriage certificate doesn't mean you have a marriage. Just because you came up to the altar. See, when we used to have a bloodline. And I remember people come up to the bloodline, standing around all around the bloodline. And just because you came up on the bloodline and said the sinner's prayer, doesn't mean you're saved. That's exactly right. Because the Bible says if you'll confess, just because you said something, but the Bible says you have to say it and then you have to believe it. And when you say it and believe it, then there's a transformation that takes place. See, the reason why you see people say, I don't understand. I don't understand a certain family member, whatever. They come up, they say the sinner's prayer, they go to church, but I don't see no change. Could it probably ain't say? Because I'm going to say, now we're not perfect. We understand that none of us are perfect. That doesn't keep us from striving to be perfect. I mean, the Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. We understand that. But it doesn't keep us from trying to be perfect. It doesn't keep us constantly. Paul says that's why he was dying daily to his flesh. Because he was working on perfection. Huh? The Bible says in Hebrews that, you know, profession, we should become professionals at our confession. In other words, what he's saying is our language should be a point that it becomes our daddy's language. When it becomes our daddy's language, that's when we're not ourselves anymore. Then that's when Satan has to obey what we say. So yesterday, last night actually, as they're saying the ceremony, they're still boyfriend and girlfriend. But the moment that my brother finished saying to my nephew, and then saying to my, now she's my niece now, at the time. Now, it's interesting because she wasn't my niece when she walked down that aisle. In fact, she wasn't even my niece standing up there. She didn't become my niece until she said something. Yep.
That's right.
Whew. And she said, I do. And when she said, I do, she... You understand what she got that moment she said, I do? She got this. Now, whether she knows what she's getting, but she gets all this. Be careful what you ask for. But, I mean, think about this. I mean, When you come into relationship with the Father, you get all this. All of a sudden, I've got a brother that I never had before. That's why Jesus, I become a brother to a brotherless, a mother to the motherless, a father to the fatherless. How is that possible? Because when you truly come in relationship, come in covenant, you get the family. So now, when you come to church, now you got a spiritual dad. But you may not have a dad. Now you got one. You can't say you don't have one because now you got one. You got a mom. You can't say I don't have a mom no more. She may have went on to heaven, but you still have a mom.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And you get a brother. Now I'll pray for some of y'all because, you know, don't get on his bad side. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. He's awesome. You don't have a bad side, my mama says. You know, mamas don't, you know, they ain't no, we can't do no wrong with mama. But we get this. I get a brother right here. I get a sister.
Hallelujah.
Never had a sister until I came into the family of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We were just all boys. But now I get all these sisters and brothers in the Lord. And because I've cut covenant, I've entered into a relationship, and now my name doesn't mean anything anymore. Now I picked up the name of the Father. That's why Abram became Abraham. He was the example. He was the prototype before Christ. Now watch this. Adam was the prototype. You know what a prototype is? A prototype is when they build something. Like, say, for example, Ford has this Recon or a big, huge Ford pickup truck. And so they took it to the Ford show. And, I mean, I happened to see this on TV about a month ago. I was watching Discovery Channel. And they brought out this truck that nobody's ever seen before. And they did something, this truck they'd never done before. And how they did the suspension systems. I mean, it's just a huge truck, massive truck. But it's the prototype. And so what they do now is once they get the prototype and they realize that it's good, then they duplicate that. And so when they bring it out from the manufacturer, they're producing one right behind the other, right behind the other, and they line them all up. You couldn't tell which one was first or which one was last. We are prototypes. We have come out of the assembly of heaven because of Abraham, because of what God did for Abraham. Watch this. He took and cut covenant with him, and so Abram became Abraham, gave him his name, and said he will be the father of many, which is us. But then here comes Jesus. They made a better model. We were good with Abraham. But we become much better. Oh my God. What we couldn't do beforehand. You know, before four-wheel drive, they had two-wheel drive. And two-wheel drive was good, but it couldn't do what four-wheel drive could do. Two-wheel drive can't go where four-wheel drive can go. Two-wheel drive can't climb what four-wheel drive can climb. Two-wheel drive can't go through what four-wheel drive can do. And all of a sudden, Jesus came, died 2,000 years ago, created a prototype that is forever and ever. Now we can go places that we couldn't go before. We can climb higher than we could ever can climb. Oh, my God, my God, my God. So now we're just like, look, you can put us all up here this morning, and you can't tell who was first, who was middle, and who was last. But watch this. This sounds good and great, and it's wonderful. But unless 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14 is prominent in your life, all this sounds great and everything. You can sit there and praise God all you want, but unless this is happening in your life, it ain't going to work for you. You can have the prototype, but you ain't got the key. All they're going to do is sit right there. And just like a lot of Christians, they just sit right there. They can't go nowhere because you can't go nowhere without the key. And the only way you can get the key is you got to be in relationship. So 2 Chronicles chapter 7 verse 14 says, if that means, remember what I told you. Now let me go back and read that to you again. In the Webster Dictionary, I don't know what my tablet's done, but that's all right. Thank God for technology. Because it says this, if means if used to say something that must happen before anything can happen. So in order for him to become the healer of your land, see, we go backwards now. And so in order before he can forgive your sins and become your healer, your savior, then something's got to happen. And this something is this, if my people who are called by my name. First of all, we got to humble ourselves. We got to walk in humility, because what that means is this. You got to shred yourself. Amen. That means you got to come to the realization that you can't do this in your own abilities. You got to come to the realization that you can't do this in your own strength. That means you got to, when you truly accept Christ, what you're saying is, I shred myself. You got to give yourself up. Amen. And see, that's what happens all the time, because we really don't want to give ourselves up. We don't want to shred ourselves. We like ourselves. But if you can like yourself all you want, but until you shred yourself, you're not going to go to that higher place. Right. You're not going to experience what God wants. The Bible says we can have heaven right here on earth. But the only way we can have heaven right here on earth, you got to have the key to get into heaven. Amen. It's just like my dad's house. I love my dad's house. And I mean, because we're in relationship, I can go into his house. I don't have to sit there and call for an appointment. I don't have to, you know, I just show up. When I'm in town, I'm staying with my dad. All right? When I leave here, I'm going there. I don't have to ask him, can I go into the refrigerator? Matter of fact, he tells me when I land. That's how good my daddy is. He knows what I like. He said, this is in the refrigerator. This is in the refrigerator. Mom has this made and that made, and this is upstairs. You know, we stay upstairs, and I look in the refrigerator, and they know I drink a lot of water. The whole refrigerator is full of water. Got coffee up there, all this for my wife. I mean, they're mom and dad. They know what I like. But because that happened, because of the relationship. You understand? Unless I was in relationship, if our relationship, if there was a wall there, then I wouldn't feel comfortable. He will always be my dad, but I would not feel comfortable. But when I go in his house because of the relationship, man, I'm at home. That's how God wants you to feel when you come into the presence. But see, this is what happens. You have to shred yourself. And you have to humble yourself. If my people who call by my name shall humble themselves, what's the first one? What's the first one? Seek. Pray. That's right. Pray, then seek. Pray. You know what prayer did? Watch this. Humble says pray. That means spend time communicating. You can't have a relationship. Remember I told you a while ago, just because you have a marriage certificate doesn't mean you have a marriage. In order to have a marriage, you got to communicate. Huh? You got to have communicate. You got to communicate. How would it be if me and my wife, we just lived in the same house and we never spoke to one another? There'd be no relationship there. You wouldn't, there'd be no benefit. There'd be nothing.
Amen.
It'd be cold. Amen. Be miserable. And there's a lot of Christians that are cold and that are miserable.
Amen.
Because the first thing they don't do is they don't pray.
Amen.
And you listen, you'll never know. Watch this. You'll never know the Father's voice.
Yes, that's right.
You'll never know your daddy's voice. Unless you spend time with your daddy. And the only way you spend time with your daddy is through prayer. My daddy, I know my daddy's voice. Why? Because I have been in his presence ever since I was born. Matter of fact, I knew his voice before I was ever born because I could hear his voice. Now let that mess around in your head a little bit. But it's because of the communication, because of the time. So first of all, listen, none of this, you have to have a relationship. That's what it's talking about. You have to humble yourself, shred yourself, and then you have to spend time with your Father. And when you spend time with the Father, get to know his voice. And then watch this. He didn't say seek his hands. See, we want to seek his hand. We want stuff. Give me, give me, give me, give me, give me. You know, that's the enemy side. That's the counterfeit. I said, that's the counterfeit, sitting here seeking his hands. Come on, give me, give me, give me. Bible says that if you seek ye first the kingdom of God, you don't have to seek for it. See, this is we spend more time trying to seek for things, and God saying, you're out of order. And if you're out of order, then none of these things are going to work. And so when you understand it, so if you seek, in other words, it says, seek my face. That means you know, and I say it like this, and I use this, before Apple ever had FaceTime, God had FaceTime. See, Apple thought they created FaceTime. They didn't. God created FaceTime. He wants to see your face. He cannot perfect your faith. My dad says it's about you, but it's also about the Heavenly Father. He cannot perfect your faith unless he sees your face. In other words, he cannot mold you and shape you in the way he wants you to be, and so therefore you can become more than a conqueror. See, I love this scripture. In Timothy, it says, thanks be unto God who always causes us to triumph. Always means always, but the only way it can be always is you got to be in relationship. So if you'll do these things, you'll pray, seek his face, turn, that means there's got to be a transformation. I said, there's got to be I don't have time to get into this. You got to have a metamorphosis experience. Do you know what I'm talking about, a metamorphosis experience? In other words, you got to go from being a caterpillar to a butterfly. And you cannot do that yourself. So you have to have a metamorphosis experience. And like I said, give me 2 more minutes. That's all I'm asking. And I'm turning it over. I'm not asking for 5. I'm giving 2. I'm going to take 5, but I'm asking for 2. Turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. Watch this. Then I will hear from heaven. Now, interesting. How is the Father hearing from heaven? He says, I will hear. Talking about the Father. I will hear from heaven. Because he's the only ones that can forgive you. He says, I will hear from heaven. So how is it possible he's going to hear from heaven? The reason why he can hear from heaven, because now all of a sudden, you're not speaking your language anymore. You're not coming from your abilities anymore. You all of a sudden, you've had a marriage ceremony. You've come in covenant, and you said, I do. And all of a sudden, now your voice is his voice. And when you begin to speak, the Holy Spirit's right there hovering, and the Holy Spirit will take your words. And where's the Holy Spirit? He lives in it's constantly in heaven. And so now when you say something, when you ask, when you're praying, and when you believe in God, all of a sudden it's not your voice anymore. It's actually his voice through you going back to heaven. Amen. And then when that happens, he says, I will forgive your sins and heal your land. That land means everything that you own. How many know your checking account can be sick? How many know your bank account can be sick? How many know you can have all the zeros in the world, but if you ain't got another number in front of it, honey. I mean, you can have all the zeros. Look, you can have all the zeros in the world, but unless you got a number in front of it, them numbers, those zeros ain't worth, they're worthless. Amen. But see, this is Jesus, watch this. Jesus is your number. Jesus is your number. Amen. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your word this morning. We thank you for your anointing and power of your Holy Spirit. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for each and every one that is here this morning. Father, I just thank you that they will not leave here the same way that they came.